stones, trying to read the signs, to tell me which way I should go to find the answer.
Rockers in Recovery Media is dedicated to carrying the message of addiction recovery through music, news, events, and festivals taking place within and not limited to the clean and sober community.
Hey, good morning. John Hollis, right here on Waking Up Blessed on Music Kingdom Radio, Rockers in Recovery Radio Productions. We are, of course, having a show this morning, Fighting the Life at Mount Sinai Ministries in Haiti, with a gentleman that, is a big part of that, Pastor Lyle Fried. And Lyle will be calling in a little bit. We're going to talk to Lyle more about what's going on with that. But I wanted to direct you to musickingdomradio.com, and you will see that part of the show this morning, of course, is going to be based off of the blog from Becky Barnett. And if you check out the blogs on musickingdomradio.com, you scroll down and you'll see the blog is right at the top of the page. You click on the first blog, that's Becky's blog, and you're able to get an understanding of what the article is about. Now, this article actually was premiered in the Music Kingdom Radio magazine, which is all part of Music Kingdom Radio magazine, the podcast, the radio shows, the radio streamers. Everything is right here at musickingdomradio.com. Please check it out. You can sign up and be a part of our newsletter. It's right at the top, subscribe, MKR newsletter. You can read the magazine online. You can also purchase the hard copy of the magazine if you'd like to have it sent to you. Please scroll around, check out the site. You can subscribe. You can do all kinds of things, get print, of course, version of the magazine. Everything can be done right there from that website. We are in the process of building out the Rockers in Recovery websites again. And we look forward to making that announcement coming up. We also have some other things that are happening. And it looks like I'm going to be taking a trip to Nashville shortly. And we got some music stuff that's going to be happening. So, you know, all in all, as I always say and always have said, more will be revealed. Give it to God and let it all happen in His time. So I want to, welcome our listeners from all over the place. We're located right here in Pocono Lake, Pennsylvania, where we woke up to 22 degrees this morning. I think fall's over, folks. So I also wanted to let you know that we are part of the Five Loaf House, which is in Pocono Pines, Pennsylvania. It's right there also on the website. Check that out. It's really important. We're going to be having some things there also coming up here shortly, and more will be announced, and we're going to start bringing in some special guests over there. So we're looking forward to having everybody a part of the Five Loaf House, Music Kingdom Radio, Rockers in Recovery, and let's get this show on the road. Good morning, Lyle.
Good morning.
How are you today?
I'm doing well. It was you mentioned 22, and that sounds a bit chilly. It falls over here in Florida too. It was 69, so when I woke up, so you know, it's a
thanks for sharing there, buddy. Yeah, it's funny how the tables turn. For many years, 25 of them to be exact, I was the guy calling people doing that to them.
Well, so God has a sense of humor. It's very overcast and rainy today, so it's not exactly beautiful out.
Well, listen, it's not 22.
That's true.
So here's the
Upper Peninsula of Michigan, and 22 he would love to have. So, you know,
I don't know how
he does it.
Hey, listen, I like your thinking. I guess you have to look at somebody else and walk in their shoes to realize how good you have it.
Yeah, absolutely. I try and get myself a regular reminder of that.
It's a true statement. So Fighting the Life at Mount Sinai Ministries in Haiti. Let's first of all talk about how your involvement started.
It kind of was a lark in a way. I was incoming president of a Rotary Club in Okeechobee, Florida, and they had wanted to do an international project in Haiti with well drilling. And they knew that my wife and I had done international work before and asked if we would be a part of that. And in particular, in this case, go down and look at just sort of tour the island, if you will, the nation, and see, you know, other water projects, what worked, what didn't, and so that we would not repeat someone else's mistakes and make sure we knew what we were doing before we got started. That was in 2009. And so we began the process of, you know, first looking at things from a distance. And as we prepared to go over, and then things got weird in early 2010, January 12th, the massive earthquake that killed an estimated 300,000 and displaced millions happened. And so our focus shifted rather quickly to relief efforts. I'm also a certified chaplain for international disaster relief. And so that was right up my alley. And we did that. And then through April, and things started to wind down for us. And we wanted to get back on task. And we started to go about the island. And they sent a driver to me, the folks I was, you know, meeting with. And the driver didn't speak a lick of English. So we communicated enough to let him know I needed a translator. And he went back and got a guy and showed up. And the guy, his name was St. Victor Sejour. He said, would you like to see, you know, we were going to an area called St. Martin in Haiti. It's in the third section of Gonaïves, Haiti. And he said he had an orphanage he wanted to show us if we had time. I said, sure, it's on the way. He says, yeah, it's on the way. So we went by to, and it turned out to be in the middle of nowhere. It's not on the way to anything, but but it was a gem in the middle of the island there. We went there and we met him and the kids and what they were doing. And they didn't have much. They had some bare land and a little building, and that was about it. They had some lean-tos that they were using as church and school. And we spent the whole day there. I never made it to my destination. I was actually going to do a revival and baptisms in St. Martin, and never made it there that day. Showed up the next day. I phoned in and told them they had to go without me. And we were getting ready to leave that night and head out to a hotel. The house mom who took care of the kids there started to cry. And my wife, you know, said, why is she crying? And St. Victor asked her and translated for us. And what happened was she had said, well, you're the first people to ever visit us from outside. And when you come, you bring hope. But when you leave, the hope goes with you. So wow. We're like, wow. You know, my wife immediately says, well, we're coming back. And you know, we've learned from mission work in, you know, that when you say something, you got to do it. I'll give you a great example of that is I was working with youth in the Andes of Ecuador. And I had said to the kids one day, I said, oh, you're all so sweet. I'd love to take you home with me. Well, they interpreted that as take you home with me, and they a few of them showed up the next day with suitcases.
Wow.
Got to be careful what you say. You know? So I looked at her, I said, you said it's got to happen. So she actually went back five times that year. I had a day gig and couldn't go as much as her, but we've been going back ever since, and we've just absolutely fallen in love with it and what they do there in their hearts, and it's been a wonderful and wild journey ever since.
What are some of the accomplishments that you've made over the last, you know, 10-plus years?
Oh, wow. That's one of the beauties of working in this area, a place where no one had ever been before. I mean, literally, as my wife rode the donkey up the mountain to an area called Goss, little kids were running and screaming because they had never seen a white person before. And at the time, the region was over 90%, you know, voodoo practitioners. So in their mind, she was a spirit come to haunt and taunt them. Just that's, I guess, what they imagined a spirit looked like, a voodoo spirit. So that was one thing we noticed is that by being the only outsiders, quote unquote, you know, and that they call us blanc, that white, to visit the region, you can see the impact of your contributions, your work, your visits, your initiatives. And so by simply supporting the work that St. Victor was already doing, and I'll back up a little and say what a man he is, because he had gone off to get educated so he could send money back to his family, but God called him to come back. He was a practicing attorney. He was also had a degree in education and worked as a teacher. So he was holding those two jobs. Teaching at two schools and working as an attorney to support the efforts that he was doing on his own there before we joined him. And his wife, who is a nurse, was working as well. I mean, the amount that they were contributing out of their own pocket to feed these kids was phenomenal, you know, when they could. So what we've seen as he's trained up other pastors and we've supplied, you know, training and training materials and Bibles, one of the most impactful things, I think, is they've gone from over 90% voodoo to over 90% Christian. And the amount of voodoo practices and priests and sacrifices of animals, et cetera, has gone down dramatically. The changes have been, I mean, if you go there, it looks like there's so much to be done. But if you can realize that in the 11 years we've been visiting, so much has happened. There's a road. Now, it's a dirt, you know, gravel, you know, carved out road, but there didn't used to be a road. It was a trail, and sometimes even a four-wheel drive couldn't get there. Now we've got a road that you can take, you know, most cars up. I mean, obviously, if it's real low riding, but most, you know, trucks or SUVs can get there now. We've got water and sanitation in there. The amount of waterborne illness was dramatic. There was zero medical care there. There was no education. Kids would go to a local, you know, basically mud hut school or go to another town to get any education at all. And when they did, they were lucky to get to sixth grade, which the sixth grade education versus no education. I mean, they learned how to read and write, and that qualified them to not do much, quite frankly. So it was a fully agrarian society. So now we built a school. That school was completed in 2012, started in 2011. So we provide a free Christian education to anybody in the community that would like it. We have some limitations based on number of teachers and stuff, but we've pretty much been doing that. We now house more children. We're just finishing, as we speak, a new two-story orphanage. We brought in some solar power and a generator. They had zero electricity in the region. They still don't have a grid, but now there's some solar and generators, so you can at least get something. At the time we first started going there, there wasn't even cell reception. Now you can actually get that. And as we built the school, we started to, you know, that was almost 10 years. It was 10 years ago we started and 9 that we finished. We opened for the 2012 school season. We've seen a lot of great things come from that. We've had several children go on to university or trade schools. We've got one of our orphans is in med school now to become a doctor. Several have finished already, and some are still working on becoming nurses. And you know, why such a focus on medical occupations isn't because they're high paying, not that they aren't, but the reason that they wanted to do those things is we talked to the young kids and asked them what they wanted to do was they wanted to be doctors and nurses because there had never been one. When we first started coming, we began organizing medical missions as well, and we'd bring down paramedics and nurses and, you know, to them, they were, you know, better than any doctor they'd ever seen because they'd never, you know, to go to a doctor there at the time. And remember, this is before they had the ability to take cars back and forth. They would put somebody on sticks. They would basically put two big sticks together and then weave palm leaves or something in between and make a bed out of it. And they would get a caravan of people, 12 people or so, that would walk for 3 days to carry them down to the nearest town where there was a doctor. A lot of people never made the trip. I never made it successfully. They died before they got there. They get there and they don't have any money because these people are the poorest in Haiti, which is the poorest nation in the hemisphere. So there you need $75 at least dollars just to see a doctor. Well, these are people who make maybe 25 cents a day. $75 is significant. It's like you or me coming up with a year's salary to for a doctor's visit. And then if they can do that.
Yeah, I think it's amazing that you know, that the kids are going where they're going. But you just brought up a great point, and I want to bring us to, because, and I'd like you to finish up some, you know, bullet points of things that have happened. But I want to talk about the financial aspect of this, because there's a lot of people that say it's all a scam when it comes to the government and it comes to other things. So let's finish up on what you're talking about. I definitely want to go in that direction if that's okay with you.
Yeah, absolutely. So they've, you know, we are, our next goal, once we finish this orphanage out, the new two-story one, we want to build a medical and community center. It'll have both multi-purpose. It'll have housing for medical missionaries. We'll have medical space, including a surgical suite. We're going to have an extensive solar power array up top to power the whole thing with a diesel generator backup. We plan on having actually air-conditioned housing. You talk about advances. When we first got there, there wasn't anything. So there's not even an outhouse. So, you know, when you got to go, it's third cactus to the left. And then we, you know, when we built the school, we built outhouses, and that began the part of our water and sanitation project. And then we put in water filtration for the orphanage. We had lost one of the orphans to waterborne illness, and we said that just can't happen. That's just something that should never happen anywhere in the world, and certainly not somewhere where we've got the capacity to make change. So we put in a water system. And we taught water and sanitation techniques, and there's now outhouses throughout the region. We've taught them, you know, practices that so that where they collect the water and where they bathe and wash their clothes are separate places. We've taught them, you know, we've actually built some septic systems. We now, on our last trip in October, for the first time in the 11 years we've been visiting, we had a flushing toilet. I can't tell you changer that is. I mean, it sounds silly to us, you know, but, you know, if you can't, if you don't know where to put it, it usually ends up going somewhere not so good. So those are just some of the changes, you know, maternal death, you know, childbirth deaths for both the infant and the mother were very high. That's gone down. Education has gone up. The poverty level, to give you an idea, most people when we got there, we're in a mud home with a thatch roof. Now the number of homes built on solid foundations with, you know, blocks and tin roof, which is, you know, it's a thin tin, but it's an upgrade. So it's a significant upgrade. So you see those, you know, throughout the region now. When we first got there, that was an extreme rarity. So the entire community of about 70,000 people has flourished during the 11 years that we've been there. And the changes seem dramatic. They're still amongst the poorest people in our entire hemisphere, but they're much better than they were. And that's the thing that I think people need to realize when you're working in a place like this is, you know, we're not, you know, that old starfish story. We're not going to save them all, but we're going to work here. And being able to stay in the one place and develop relationships and see the efforts. I think there's a mistake that a lot of missionaries make. They do, particularly short-term missions. You go, you build something, or you drop some money in a bucket, and you feel good, and you go home. You don't remember anybody's name. You don't know. You didn't ask them what their needs were. You built something you wanted to build. We've learned to meet with the people of the community, to talk with the people, to sit inside their mud huts and, you know, converse with them about what they want. So we're on the same page with them, and they're like family to us now. We're part of their community, and they're part of ours. And so we know the needs, we understand it, and they understand the difficulty in getting it all done. They know that my wife and I are not wealthy people. Our hearts are large for them, and we love them, and we'll do what we can. And that's pretty much how it works. And the beauty of seeing those changes and watching these children grow up and turn into fine young adults that live a good, godly life is gold in itself. It's better than any paycheck I've ever received.
You know, it's funny that you just really described what I was getting ready to talk about, because there is a huge misconception, in my opinion, of folks that believe that it's like, you know, something's going to take 10 minutes when it takes years to accomplish. And what do I mean by that? I mean, listen, we can look at our own, you know, misgivings and misfortunes. Let's just look at Hurricane Andrew. When I got to Miami, when I moved to Miami, it was in just late 92, of course, into 93. And, of course, the Hurricane Andrew had devastated the South Florida. It was 2005 or 2006 when they were finally, you know, finishing up the restoration of South Florida to the best of their abilities at that point. So, you know, how many years did that take in a country that has everything at its disposal? So
right.
When you think about the hurricanes and the earthquakes and the new earthquake that just took place recently, right? So you have all of these things that have happened over all of these times, over the last decade plus, and you can't just say, listen, it's going to all happen overnight. They were already poor and dysfunctional to begin with, correct?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So to go in and try to make things happen and then have natural disasters occurring all around you during that time period makes it almost impossible. You gain and then you lose, correct?
Yeah, and there's so many misconceptions about Haiti, and I think there's a lot of stigma with Haiti. You know, I work in substance abuse and mental health, and I understand the stigmas there. I was once homeless and worked with the homeless for many years. I understand the stigma there, and I'll tell you that none of them compare to the stigma and the misconceptions about Haiti. First of all, everybody assumes that if you send money to Haiti, it's, you know, the government's taking 80%, and that's just not true. First of all, the government doesn't even recognize the region that we work in. They don't know what we do, what we don't do. They don't even recognize that these people exist. They're known in the area as the forgotten people because the government doesn't acknowledge them. So there's no government involvement, so there's no government skimming. Now, I will say if I bring something into the port, I got to pay duties, and you know the government gets their share that way if I ship something in a container. But as far as the work we're doing, they're not involved. You know, 100% of the monies we receive go directly to the ministry on the ground there. Nobody stateside takes a penny. We do pay the staff there, the teachers, the ladies who cook for the kids, and you know the pastor and the principal. You know, we do have staff there. But they don't get paid much. You know, the highest paid people over there are the more tenured teachers who make $120 a month. That's our big spend, you know, which, you know, in our standards is like, what? and these are people who walk for sometimes 4 hours each direction each day to come teach there. It's frankly, they're underpaid. The other misconception about it is that, well, if they're only making 25 cents a day, everything must be really cheap there. And that's everything is actually more expensive there because you think about it, they don't produce much there. You know, there's some rice, some sugar, and they export now some coffee and chocolate and a little moringa, but those aren't things that they consume much of. So if you want any building supplies, if you want deodorant, I'll give you an example. This was 8 years ago, I had a friend who was staying there for a period of time. He says, Lyle, when you come down, bring me some deodorant. And I said, listen, you don't have to wait for my trip. I saw it in the store in the nearby town. He says, yeah, it's $18 a stick for the cheap stuff. Well, why?
Wow.
Why is everything so expensive there? Well, because you got to buy it here in the States, pay to ship it there, got to pay duties to get it out, and then they got to mark it up to make all that worthwhile in the store. It's, you know, and so they don't, it's a closed-loop economy. If it weren't for the expatriates from there who've come to the U.S. and other places to get jobs and send money back. And if it weren't for aid, Haiti has been cut off from commerce since they became the first independent black republic in the world in 1804. They were completely cut off and ostracized by every other country in the world. And unfortunately, they've never recuperated from that. You know, over 200 years of being cut off. And at the time, they were a cotton plantation. Well, you know, you got a bunch of slaves who were illiterate and uneducated who knew how to grow cotton really well, but nobody's buying cotton from you. So, and you can't.
Didn't they bring
cotton,
in coffee? Didn't they bring in coffee and sugar at that time too? I think they were trying
They did somewhat. As a matter of fact, they originally were the. If you ever heard of like Jamaican Blue Mountain, the original Blue Mountain coffee was in Haiti. It was, you know, premium,
right.
And they still grow a very good premium coffee at a very affordable price there. It's really good stuff. You know, I'm a coffee connoisseur, but a coffee snob, if you will. And the coffee that they grow there, some of the coffee they grow there is just phenomenal. And some of the best in the world. And because they are so impoverished, they'll grow it. It's cheap. I mean,
yeah,
you know, compared to other premium coffees around the world, it's very, very affordable. And I would like to see more of that happen. There are some folks that are really pushing to grow the coffee and chocolate, coffee, cacao, and moringa trades there. A friend of mine, Guy Buckmaster, out of the Sarasota, Florida area, is very big in, you know, producing that in the northern region. But it's, yeah, it's an expensive place to live. And to remember, each, particularly like this village, it's a closed economy. So, you know, there's this, you know, group of people, and, you know, they're trading tomatoes for onions and, you know, chickens for goats, and that's their bank account. You know, their crops and their is their bank account. When I say there's nothing there, there's no banks, there's no police station, there's no infrastructure whatsoever. It's really so just a bunch of people off the land.
So you're fighting against the whole bureaucracy part of this thing too, and we already know. And I mean, listen, from every thing I know, the government is corrupt. I mean, listen, you know, call it what it is. And now there isn't even one. You guys were just there. We also had missionaries from Wesleyan Church that were down there around the same time you were. You had everything break loose on the security side of this thing where, you know, we had, 17 missionaries that were taken hostage during the time period that you were there and that the time that our guys were there. So it was – I mean, where is the government in all of this trying to help with the, you know, with the cause? It doesn't look like – it looks like it's non-existent.
Well, yeah, and again, you got to realize what you're working with. So you've got to – there's a interim government, but even before the president was assassinated, you had not much of a government. The foreign nations had pulled out completely. Support had dropped significantly. There's debates about what – I'll be honest with you, it's not – you know, when you think about it politically, it's got some parallels to our country. They've basically got two power factions, think, you know, in our world, two parties, Democrat and Republican, that disagree, but they also have – the two of them, you know, have wrestled back and forth power from each other over the decades. And they've been sometimes better and sometimes worse. And I don't know that either one's better or worse than the other, but anybody, you know, who wants to do anything different doesn't fit into that power scheme. You've got, just like what you've got here, you've got an elite that tend to run things more or less, and the people may vote, but I won't mention names because I want to get political about it, but there was one guy who came in as president and really wanted to do things different, but he couldn't get anything done in Haiti because he wasn't part of the system. So neither side wanted to work with him. So he ended up, quite frankly, being very ineffective and therefore disliked and voted out next time. And so it's not an unusual situation in that regard. It's just that it's exaggerated because of the conditions there and the lack of resources. Then there is, of course, you know, a level of corruption that, you know, I've worked all through the Caribbean. I used to be, long story, but I used to be art director for Air Jamaica. And I've been on just about every island there is in the Caribbean. And there's corruption everywhere. Graft is sort of a given in South and Central America and the Caribbean. It's a cultural norm. And so Haiti's no different. And when you take the fact that they're the most impoverished nation in the hemisphere, the opportunities, the ability to bribe somebody, it's cheaper, right? I mean, if you're used to making 20 cents a day and I offer you 10 bucks, that goes a long way. You know, it means a lot more than 10 bucks would, you know, here in my town. You know, so it's a ripe situation and it's difficult to change. And I will say that the way we've done it previously as a nation and as ministries hasn't always been effective. The most effective thing that happens there is just what we're doing. And I'm not trying to toot our horn. I'm talking about how to get things done. And that is small ministries that go in and meet with locals and develop relationships and do the work. The most effective organizations there are those. Things like Rotary, because they have Rotary clubs there, so you know locals and you can work within the local system. Samaritan's Purse, who is, you know, when the earthquake of 2010 happened, everybody, you know, got all excited and people were sending money, a lot of which never made it there. But then the dust settles and it's no longer the charity of the moment. And by the end of January, the only ones left were Samaritan's Purse, Rotary, and small ministries. The Red Cross was nowhere to be seen. You know, the Clinton Foundation was nowhere to be seen. All these big names that were out there talking about what they were going to do just disappeared. The ones that stuck
You also have that entity that, you know, hey, listen, send money and only 10% is going to make it there.
And there is that. And then there's and listen, I understand there's some good organizations that do similar things to what we do on a larger scale, but they have a large overhead. And so I tell people, you know, we 100% whatever shows up on a donation, 100% of it goes there. We don't have that 40% overhead that most people do. Yeah. We're small enough. We all work multiple jobs and put in our own money to support it. So there's no need for that. That's been our heart from the beginning. Don't get me wrong. I'd love to have a budget where I could drop my day gig and do this full time. That's not the reality that we live in. But I get why I could do a lot more if that were an option. But it's also
that being said, where can people send money to the cause? Where can they go to have that happen?
The easiest way to do it is through our website. And our website, it's Mont Sinai, M-O-N-T, no U, Mont Sinai, it's the French. It's mont-sinai.com. It's really easy, mont-sinai.com. And there's a donation portal. You'll see several ways to get there. But on the left side, there's a support tab. That you can hit, and it gives you options of, you know, doing a child sponsorship, one-time donations, monthly donations. It's we try and make it as easy as possible, and you immediately get a receipt for your taxes. We are a 501c3 registered in the U.S., so we are a tax-deductible organization. And it tells you a little bit about us, and it's a great thing to get to know us. And, of course, they can always call me. I'm very accessible. As you can see, there's no difficulty in getting me to talk about it. It is a true heartstring for me, and I'm happy to do it. We just went down this last time. We brought a film crew from a Christian TV show that's now in post-production to put together a half-hour program for them, and I want to get that on the website when it's ready.
Very cool. Also, if you're interested, you can go to musickingdomradio.com and click on the blog in regards to the show. That's right there. Of course, it's right at the top of the screen. You'll see the blog, and it says Fighting the Life at Mount Sinai Ministries. And what you want to do is just scroll down, and the link that Lyle was talking about is right there, too. Lyle, give me your phone number, so if they want to give you a call directly, they can.
Sure. It's 772-3711. Again, that's 772-332-8711. Very accessible until about 9 o'clock, and then I go to bed. I usually stick my room, and that's my self-preservation moment. But other than that, I'm typically very easy to reach.
The funny part of this story is I say to Lyle, you know, I've got everything together. We're going to start doing shows again. What do you want to do, 9 a.m. or 9 p.m.? And what do you think Lyle's response was? So in closing, Lyle, I want to thank you not just for what you're doing here, but what you do overall as helping people, may it be from the addiction community to the community as a whole, and to, of course, your international ministries and what you're doing. It's just amazing, and you're everywhere. And that's the Spirit of God working through you. If you can't see that, then, maybe it's time to look at ourselves, you know, because we see people out there, and they're working hard, and they have a purpose behind them. And it might not be the same purpose you have, but here's the good news. It doesn't have to be. God gives us all different purposes. Would you agree, Lyle?
Right. Absolutely. I'll tell you, I get a little flack, and people say to me, you know, why are you doing so much work in Haiti when there's needs here in the U.S.? And I say, well, first of all, I do work here. I've opened homeless shelters, food, soup kitchens, treatment centers. I have done and continue to support all of that. And a matter of fact, if that's your focus, I'll get you plugged in. You want to find a quality place to help people here in the States, I will do that with you. But part of the reason why I do it there is again, because, first of all, having done all that here and having been homeless in the States, I can tell you that the homeless here live and eat better than the wealthy in this community that I work with. And it's where God has put on my heart. He hasn't taken the other things off my heart. I still have a heart for people here. And that's really what, you know, the book of James, you know, faith without works, you know, is talking about, is that if you have a true faith, God is, it's going to be exhibited in how you live your life. And it all comes about loving others. And that's what God has given me, is a love for others. Why would I ever go there? I mean, why, you know, why would I take the time, the money, and the effort to get to a place that people don't want to be? Well, because God has put it on my heart and given me a love for them that is beyond my own comprehension. And I hope that you find that for yourself as well, because there's nothing more fulfilling than finding a role that God has given you, that he created you for from before the foundations of the earth, and doing that.
And that's an always changing process. Isn't it amazing how he grows upon things? You know, the five loaf house and the stuff that we're doing up here, it's amazing to watch the transformation of just being started to where it's going and all of that. And you've been doing this for a long time, so you see the hand of God through all of it. So it's an amazing thing to watch it happen.
Yeah, it is. Anytime he's in it, it's worth doing, that's for sure.
Lyle, I want to thank you for being on the show this morning, and most importantly, I want you to know that we're always here for you. Lyle also has, so that way people are aware, if you're in South Florida, we are distributing the Music Kingdom Radio magazine, the MKR magazine. Lyle has some. You can go to the church, which is the Recovery Church, on Saturdays and pick up a copy if you'd like, correct, Lyle?
Correct. We have it on our Saturday Recovery Church as well as the Sunday service for Crossing Community Church. So anybody who's in the Treasure Coast area, you know, just feel free to give me a call. I'd love to get a copy in your hands. I'm actually taking some with me this weekend to Central Florida for the Came to Believe Recovery Retreat. If you're going to be in that area, you know, reach out to me.
Everything that the magazine is doing right now, just so everybody is aware, we're sending it out to multiple churches. We'll have a list up, but we're doing it free to all of the churches. If you do purchase it online, you're doing that because you want to help support, of course, the print and all of that, because trust me, you know, if you know the cost of everything right now, you know that it's a dying breed, print. But at the same token, I'm finding that it's changing. People do want to read, and they don't want people following them online. So they basically will get the magazine and read it because, you know, hey, listen, if you got people tracking everything you're doing, they know what you're reading, they know what you're saying, they know what you're doing, correct?
Well yeah, and I think our brains absorb it differently in print. In fact, not only think that, I know that. I've read the research on it, and I know that we retain and absorb information differently off paper than we do off a screen.
In closing, thank you. I want to let everybody know that this is an on-demand show now. Give it about 10 minutes, and the show that you're listening to live right now will become on-demand, and you can share the same link that's out there with everybody, to friends or family that you might want to have hear this show. You can check us out at musickingdomradio.com. I want to thank Lyle for being on the show with us, and we'll have you back in the future and update us on what's happening down there. And most importantly, God bless you and your ministries, and our love to your wife, darling. She, of course, I'm sure, is the wind beneath your wings.
Absolutely. She is the best named person I know. Has the most appropriate name you can get. So she is everything she appears to be, the most loving person I've ever met. So I'm a blessed man.
There you go. And with that, folks, thanks for tuning in. Lyle, we'll talk soon. God bless.
All right, you too. Thanks.
With the Lucky Land Slots, you can get lucky just about anywhere.
This is your captain speaking. We've got clear runway and the weather's fine, but we're just going to circle up here a while and get lucky. No, nothing like that. It's just these cash prizes add up quick. So I suggest you sit back, keep your tray table upright, and start getting lucky.
Play for free at LuckyLandSlots.com. Are you feeling lucky? No purchase necessary. Void where prohibited by law. 18 plus terms and conditions apply. See website for details.